I'm Laura Shepherd, Director of Events here at the Mechanics Institute. And I want to thank you for joining us here for our program with Obi Kaufmann for his new book, The Deserts of California, A California Field Guide. I see a lot of new faces in the audience tonight, so if you're new to Mechanics Institute, we were founded in 1854 and were one of San Francisco's most literary and cultural centers in the heart of the city. We feature our general interest library, an international chess club, ongoing author and literary programs, our cinema film series every Friday night, and many other offerings for you all under one roof. So please visit our website and see what's going on here 7 days a week. After our talk, we'll have a Q&A with you, our audience. And of course, books will be here for sale, and Obi will be here to sign your books personally. I'd also like to remind you that in the next few weeks, we have some great events coming up. The important event, of course, is our annual biannual members meeting on December 7th, next Thursday. And then following that, on Thursday, December 14th, we have our annual holiday gathering, which is a party not to be missed. So please make your reservations now in advance and join us for some celebrations. Also, after this program, Alyssa Stone, our Senior Director of Programming, who's in the back, will give a tour of the library and our institute for those who would like to join. So she's right in the back, and she's right there saying hello. So, San Francisco Chronicle's number one best-selling author, Obi Kaufmann, of the Canonical California Field Atlas, returns with an epic, forward-looking exploration of the state's arid eastern regions. The Deserts of California, a California Field Atlas, blend science and art in Kaufmann's signature style to throw into relief ecological insights greater than either might yield alone. Through expressionistic mapmaking, wildlife renderings, and geographic conservation guides, Kaufmann explores the marvels and the threats to these resilient yet sensitive ecosystems. Obi Kaufmann is the author of the California Field Atlas, number one, the San Francisco Chronicle bestseller, The State of Water, The Forests of California, and The Coasts of California, that are all published by Heyday. When he's not backpacking, you can find him, the painter poet, at home in the East Bay, posting trail paintings at his handle Coyote Thunder on Instagram and also on his website coyoteandthunder.com. I call Obi a modern John Muir with a little touch of Walt Whitman in there as well. But basically, he's got the heart of a philosopher. So please welcome back to Mechanics Institute's Obi Kaufmann.
Let's see how this goes. Okay, so I've got this device in front of my face. We're gonna see how this goes here. I tend to gesticulate with my hands and stuff, so I might knock everything over and wire. We'll see how it goes. I appreciate your patience with me because of that. I so appreciate you being here tonight. I'm so glad to be back at San Francisco's oldest lending library. This is my fourth time back now. Has anybody seen me here talk before? Tonight I have something different in store. I meander through some thoughts I have for the next half an hour or so. I like what Laura said very much. Thank you, Laura, for that warm introduction. At least she got the word philosopher in there, which is a word that means something. I like specifically ecological philosophy. In fact, I'd like to deputize you all here tonight as ecological philosophers. You have a relationship to nature. You think about yourself in terms of that greater context. whether you are a cellular being or a networked being, yourself is not just contained in this vehicle, but rather spread out over this infinity of relationships, which is ecology. This big, when I start talking like this, I feel like what I need to do is I need to start with, I mean this non-sarcastically, but there is a twitch of a particular kind of ideology that needs to be confronted, especially in this postmodern context that we find ourselves in the 21st century regarding all things true or epistemological. How do we know what is true? And what I need to do then is offer you some kind of, frankly, trigger warning. I've been criticized recently for a couple of things that I want to take seriously. Criticized is a good way of framing it. The information, the values attached to the facts, right? These are the things, right? This is where you have the consilient knowledge, the unity of all knowledge between the facts, which are most and best derived from the physical sciences, and then we have the values, right, which are most and best derived from the humanities, these two great centers of human knowledge and tradition in that regard. And how do we bring those together? In fact, but I have been observed to potentially be patriarchically rationalistic.
No.
Well, thank you, sir, for what I'm sure is an outburst of pride and sanity, and I appreciate that, but I really want to not deny a worldview that you have built personally, your own psychology, in this tortured psychological landscape of disorders, whether they be personal or perhaps even driven by those nefarious and virulent algorithms that we have so bought into day in and day out, as we can't help but feed some particular neurochemistry in our mind for these computers that we all carry around in our pocket. We have these algorithms that are feeding us this thing, which is really having this deleterious effect on our children, as much as anyone else, in terms of something that might be described as climate anxiety, and certainly has been described as climate anxiety in terms of what seems to be unfolding here in the 21st century. So this is a function of my own ontological conclusions. Ontology is the study of why there is stuff. And how do we interpret the stuff of the world, the stuff of the world? My father, Dr. William Kaufmann III, astrophysicist, when I was born in Hollywood, and he was the director of the Griffith Observatory throughout high school. It was calculus homework every day after school. I was going to be a mathematician. And he said to me, he said, Bill, which was my name at the time in high school, he said, mathematics is the language of reality. And I would run away from that, sometimes quite literally up to Mount Diablo, my sacred lonely peak over there in the East Bay wherein I, cut my teeth as a young naturalist playing with tarantulas, climbing waterfalls, and mapping sage mazes, and teaching myself how to draw birds. thinking, okay, so if it's the language of reality, I'm also feeling this, okay, so it's only half the equation. The other piece of the variable there is my mother. My father married a clinical psychologist. So that's the stew, right? That's the stew in the mind. two, to, you know, the very strange question that I just posed, I would have said, story. What is it about the story? In fact, my second book here, The State of Water, Understanding California's Most Precious Resource, the intimation then being that the liquid stuff itself is our most precious resource here in this political entity that is California society. During that book, across the state, from San Diego to Crescent City to Bakersfield to Fresno to Truckee to San Bernardino County, you know, wherever, all shades of blue, purple, and red, rural and urban, poor and rich, I find that no, our most precious resource is the ability to trust each other with a story, especially in a democratic context, small d, which is an ideal, which is an epic that I aim never to stray from. And that involves telling the truth. And what is the truth that I'm getting at? Well, the truth I'm getting at would probably be the second part of the trigger warning that I need to wade through here with you, which is this idea of toxic positivity, that somehow I am denying trauma by suggesting that the solutions exist, or by suggesting that the solutions are largely technical in origin and in solution, that we can figure these things out one at a time. And barring that, we're going to do something not unlike what Wendell Berry describes, which would be solving for pattern. If you don't know that name, Wendell Berry, please get on that. Agrarian philosopher who has quite a bit of quotes that I use regularly. and a fantastic way of thinking as well. In regard to land ethics, certainly the inheritor of something like an Aldo Leopold. Right, I appreciate more the comparison to John Muir. Of course, I mean, what a great writer. In fact, I mean, well, John Muir wrote The Mountains of California. But his legacy is largely one of, well, certainly sparking the modern conservation movement, at least on a popular sense, which is nice. But there are certainly are indigenous people in the world right now suffering from those ideas that he had. And those ideas he had were largely based in ecological ignorance, given what we know now. He didn't know what he was looking at. And it could be that I don't know what I'm looking at here. These stories are both very old and very new. What do I mean by that? Okay, so as the publishing cycle goes in the construction of these books, I tell you, I'm a desperate man. I am running from one book to the next, and I am thinking, I know, I'm putting a book out about once in 18 months or so. And it's all day, every day. It's such a joy, it's such a dance. I feel like I've sort of essentialized my life down to these four things, right? Which is like walking, reading, painting, and writing. If I could just keep doing that. I live in, you know, Rockbridge over in Oakland. You know, I live a city guy's life after having spent most of my years so far walking the city. And thus the pedestrian epic of what the field atlas is. There are no roads in these books. I'm not really concerned about the red lines on the map. not a destination. I'm not gonna wake up someday like a dreading that we do in 2030 after the 30 by 30 successfully protects, you know, which is our state law now. Y'all know about 30 by 30 yet? Okay, well, I'll go ahead and bring the 30 by 30. Now state law originally passed as a executive order under the Newsom administration, and now a state law just 3 weeks old that by 2030 we will protect 30% of California's lands and California's local waters for the expressed purpose of biodiversity conservation and for corridor and habitat connectivity, and for not extractive development purposes. Okay, so those last few phrases are my own sort of, you know, interpretation of it. But biodiversity is in the center of the whole thing, in the center of the whole vision. Now, I have a lot of criticism about this. For example, like I'm saying, like it's not a destination. We're not going to wake up on January 1st, 2030 and be like, oh, right, nature's saved. This is a stepping stone. And I applaud the policymakers in Sacramento now for such efforts. The policymakers in Sacramento. You know, tonight, Newsom is taking on DeSantis in a debate. Thank you all for being here right now. you know, I don't know what democracy is, but it feels like this right now. You know, when I'm presenting my work at the Farmers Association in Fresno, say, you know, or and I have a seat at the table, and I meet everyone on the political spectrum, and nobody wants to see California win. What they think. So what then is the common story? How do we begin to tell this democratically born ethos? So I got these books coming out every 18 months. The Deserts book I finished well over a year ago, and now I'm working on my sixth book, which will sort of complete this round of field atlases as they were and are. And that book will be entitled The State of Fire, Understanding How, Where, and Why California Burns. And it's been all building up to this. This story. Getting right with this idea, this process, this key aspect of the landscape's adaptive cycle. What fire is in California? It's a deep time story. I'm going to get a little poetic here as we endeavor into that. It's related to ghosts, it's related to forests. Those three books together make the California Lands Trilogy. Okay, and so there is a temporal component in that the forests, first book, represents what can be the evolutionary past of California. not only the herbivores, like three species of mammoth, sloth, bison, all manner of amazing creatures who are no longer extant across the biosphere, but also the predators that came along with them, including one of the largest bears that ever lived, the short-faced bear that puts the grizzly bear to shame on all manner of dimension and aggressiveness, apparently, as we understand by the fossil record. In any case, the weather, the climate began to shift. And it was about this time that humanity showed up and we saw the Holocene extinctions happen. And there was, you can imagine across the entire floristic province here that all of those species of herbivores were doing a lot of grazing. So herbivores do. And then come the first Californians, the first human Californians. And over the next several thousand years, they develop what can be called, and has been called, pyrocultural economies. They used fire in a way that was consciously eschewing of agricultural processes that, this is a very interesting theory, consciously avoiding agricultural technologies that have been used by the Occident across Western Asia and Europe since Babylon, 5,000 years ago. There is this bias, I think, that still very much persists and exists today of this ascension, if you will, of culture to finally figuring out agriculture, as if there isn't any other way to extract nutrient wealth from the soil. When in fact, across California, for thousands of years, for millions and millions of people, the technology was not agricultural at all. It was pyroculture. And the amount of fire that happened on the landscape across the California floristic province, not only was just a huge amount, I mean, it was so much fire. I mean, in 2020, we had 4 million acres. I can't believe much fire. We suspect that in pre-Columbian California, we had between 6 and 10 million acres a year. Now, these were a different kind of fire. Usually we're talking about an average size of about 500 acres with maybe a 10-acre signature burn. Okay. Compared to now with today's mega fires, or most recently, our first gigafire, the Mendocino Complex fire. There was history of megafire in pre-Columbian California, but nothing like the rate at which it's happening today in what is the Anthropocene. Okay, so this kind of ties back into the trigger warning too. I know there's some kids here, and I appreciate that. I want to have a great grown-up conversation that almost amounts to something like I want to present something like almost like a graduate seminar in sort of California ecological philosophy. So I will be talking about the end of the world. And I'm also going to talk about how the world doesn't end. You know, I think you all can handle this discussion, because I don't think these thoughts are gloomy at all. I think that we also need to approach some ethical, moral choices too in what we and how we approach things like the future. So then we have the forest, and so what happened? What happened over the past several thousand years that native California technology began to anthropogenically, a human-caused design this landscape. Every acre across California, of course, was stewarded by human hands for thousands of years. It was only, the modern configuration You know, I do this podcast every month with Greg Saris, who's the chairman of the Federated Indians up at Creighton Rancheria in Santa Rosa. He's a professor of literature in UCLA and Stanford. We talk a lot about the stories that he stewards in his book. He's a heyday author as well. And most of the podcasts are kind of like, you know, it's almost like Shakespearean character analysis of coyote or chicken hawk or, you know, a coyote married a frog woman, you know. So, you know, discussing what sacred time is in terms of the thing that is now, when animals were people, and what that means to you and to me. And anyway, talking with Greg about the end of the world, he'll say things like, no, we've seen the world end many times. Can you imagine 6,000 years ago? People just standing not far from the spot where we are right now, looking out at the San Francisco estuary, and it's estimated that at that time, the bay filled up with The bay was created with sea level rise that was equivalent to about 3/4 of an inch a year. So you just basically watch the basin fill. And what a dramatic transformation in the landscape and the physiography of this little place. It must have felt like the end of the world. Or you think of Greg and the Southern Pomo and the coastal Miwok. The beginning of the 20th century, there was 14 Southern Pomo left. They were all living. Now there's over 1,500 tribal members. This great resurgence of Native people across California. And finally now, even within the past 5 years, getting a seat at the table in Sacramento in a way that they've never had before. Escaping the genocide, the enslavement, and ultimately the cultural erasure, all of which failed across the state of California. We're still in the process of recovering, but the trend is good. And I think the trend is good across a great many things in California, certainly, and the biosphere. Certainly since I wrote that first book, California Field Atlas, in 2015 when I wrote that book, thinking, hey, we're about to have a female president. She's got, you know, some semblance of an environmental policy that dig into all the mama's thing, got a trajectory. Boy. So long 8 years ago. But my attitude has shifted so much since I wrote that first book about so many things. So much has happened over the past 8 years. So much regeneration. So much hope. I'll go toe-to-toe with you all night about every point of despair. There's a counterpoint of hope. Don't bet against us yet. Don't bet against this. It is my contention that so complete is this vision for what can be, given by what has just happened over the past 8 years, that it is quite possible that we leave the more than human or the natural world of California in better shape in the 21st century than we left it at the end of the 20th century. And the devil's in the details, and you have to give the devil his due. But this is the course of this exploration. It's a human story. The forest is the past. The coasts is the present. My second book in the California Lands Trilogy, the first line of which is that this is a time capsule. The coasts of California are not ecologically what they were 100 years ago, and they are not what they will be 100 years from now. This is a dynamic place that is shifting and changing all the time. It is our charge, our moral imperative, world is California having just taken over Germany?
The amount of economic wealth that we have on our shoulders, most of which, if not all of it, how about this for a grand leap from that to this, it is even more so than the climate crisis, whatever the climate crisis may or may not be. Because it's my contention that the Anthropocene isn't going to be a geologic era. It's going to be something more akin to an event. Whether or not it's going to be a mass extinction or not is still on the table. Do not condemn to die that which is not dead. We are very good at saving endangered species, and we're getting better. There's three kinds of biodiversity. There's genetic biodiversity, there's landscape biodiversity, and there's species biodiversity. Okay, so we have to keep all three of those. Why do we need all this biodiversity? Why do I care if the delta smelt go extinct or not? It's just a minnow. Biodiversity forms together this network of vectors of resilience that form this architecture of resilience. And there's a straight mathematical equation based on the transitive property. One thing equals another thing equals another thing. That goes like this. Biodiverse means healthy ecosystems. That's how ecosystems work. The greater the diversity, the greater resiliency any ecosystem is towards any disturbance event. Okay. Healthy ecosystems supply regulated and normalized regimes of ecological services, whether they be earth, air, water. These ecological services have supplied, fueled, and funded every human society since the beginning of time, and they always do. Everywhere. At every place, at every time. Okay. So, remember, in all things ecological, we have this new story and we have this old story. We're still learning a lot. Oh, this story is so new. There are people in this room who were born before we understood the theory of island biogeography. MacArthur and Wilson wrote in 1968 the theory of island biogeography, and this is the first mathematical, theoretical, scientific analysis of how speciation actually occurs in a Darwinian context. It turns out that Darwin's book in 1858 on the origin of species does not actually do what the title purports. Does not actually explain what the title purports that it's supposed to do. It doesn't describe the origin of species. It describes evolution by natural selection. Didn't understand that, and we didn't have a Darwinian philosophy on the landscape until the 60s, until 15 years after we understood deoxynucleic acid. You know, like after the human genetics were, the code was cracked, the helix was found, almost 15 to 20 years before we had even an idea of how speciation occurs. And this is almost the thing that I want to talk to Greta Thunberg about. It's like things are changing so rapidly in our minds. This is about the time that we even understood we were stewards of the planet at all. You know, there's this incredible backlash from the youth right now. It's just like blaming the elder generations for not knowing more. It's like, oh, that's terribly unscientific. After that book, the golden age of environmental legislation, 71 to 75, when we had things like the Clean Water Act, the Clean Air Act, the Endangered Species Act, the invention of the Environmental Protection Agency, all under the Nixon administration, passing through both houses of Congress, 98% approval. Everything flew through. Of course we want to do this. This was the telling of a better story, not the making of a better argument, which I think is an incredibly powerful something that may or may not be absurd, right? I'm gonna step on anybody's toes here. But you know, like I don't get spirituality. I don't see that myself. But I'm trying to figure it out all the time. You know, I certainly believe this thing called beauty, and yet this aesthetic philosophy that's infused in all my work, challenging my father all the time about what the language of reality may or may not be. But I understand faith as it's tied to hope. Faith is a posture towards the future. Faith being the thing that makes tomorrow possible. We're gonna figure this out. So finally, I get around to the future, the last book in the California Lands Trilogy, The Deserts of California, which really spends a lot of time thinking about the difference between a mature desert ecosystem and desertification. Given, you know, climate models are all over the place, I tend to not use the term climate change. I think it's a little anesthetized, and I'm not sure we're talking about. I really like the idea of like something like climate breakdown by way of anthropogenic global warming. It's very specific. But I'm really concerned about scientific literacy and mathematic literacy. You know, you hear in the media, you hear like a ton of carbon. What are we talking about? Like, a ton of carbon is a meaningless statement. Okay, are we talking about an American ton, which is 2,000 pounds? Or are we talking about a metric ton, which is 1,000 kilograms, 100 pounds? Are we talking about carbon, which is 3.3, a pound of carbon dioxide is 3.3 times as heavy as a pound of carbon. Are we talking about carbon dioxide? I mean, can we please just like get the math straight? Or can we get our language correct? I don't know. I mean, if we can try, you end up writing huge 700-page books. But, you know, I gave my best shot. So, the future. What is the future in the deserts of California? The deserts of California are doing a lot of, remember I talked about 30 by 30. It's a lot of discussion of 30 by 30. You say a lot. You all figure it out. Newsom is no dummy. He wants a win here, and he designed this policy for the win. I think we can get there. We're at about 26% California lands now that qualify under these very strict guidelines. Most, you know, half the state is locked up in under federal protection with the U.S. Forest Service, right? But that doesn't qualify. You heard of the land of many uses, right? There's still so much utility, so much utilitarian value extracted from those resources. The commodity, timber, say. But in the desert has almost half of this 30% in California, even though it's only 25% of the entire state. So a lot, but even, and this is another one of my criticisms, protecting 30% doesn't mean trashing 70%. We've got a lot of debate to have about net carbon neutrality by the year 2045, which is another gubernatorial mandate. We're not going to drive our way out of this. I don't know. I mean, here I am in San Francisco. I don't know if I've got some car people in here. You know, the electric car is not a panacea towards the climate emergency or the biodiversity emergency. As we are now working towards that goal, we are going to be eliminating over 250,000 acres of desert habitat and environment to put up solar panels. Solar panels, most of which at this point, this is a lot of technology that we don't have yet. The solar power panels they're installing have a lifespan of about 40 years. They have rare earth elements like cobalt, all of which comes from the Democratic Republic of Congo. Lying to myself, 7-year-old is the old answer. And you say solar panels need to be washed. You gotta yet, I'm also seeing and having faith in different things. Remember, we're also having faith, we talked about this a lot in the book too, the idea of emergence in complex patterns. Okay, complexity theory is a pillar of my whole thought here with ecological philosophy. And all complex systems, I'm talking about complexity, I'm not talking about complicated things. Your watch is a complicated system, it's not a complex system. The complex system exists across a matrix of dancing variables, if you will, whatever we're talking about. Okay, but we know one of the common phenomena that happen to all complex systems is emergence. What is happening? I mean, we could talk about emergence. But emergence is related to feedback loops. It's related to cascading systems of effects. And one of the things we see, for example, now that the United States is emitting less carbon emissions than it did in 1990 because of the switch from coal to gas, it looks like on a global level we have avoided the truly apocalyptic parameters as set by the IPCC of the 4 degrees to 8 degrees centigrade by the year 2100. It looks like that's not, we're not going to get anywhere near that. This is, you know, and when I wrote that first book 8 years ago, that was not, we did not have that data yet. The story is changing rapidly, and yet the algorithms want to tear us apart. So, just to conclude, faith in the future, hope. You know, I'm so inspired, even more so than the environmental movement. Really inspired by the civil rights movement in the 60s. You know, things like, you know, environmentalists. Environmentalists. I'm not here as an environmentalist. I'm not here as a person with a political agenda to ram. You know, I'm not here with an argument. I'm here with a better story, because I think that's the only thing that ever changes anybody's mind at all. So, you know, I think I'll just end with Cornel West's quote that brought up civil rights. He said, never be surprised by evil and never be paralyzed by despair.
Yes.
And I think about this stoking of my own faith, my own hope towards that posture of what is beautiful, of what is to be celebrated, of what is still alive and still beautiful. This miracle we stewarded. I don't know what democracy is, but we sure feel like that tonight here. Thank you so much for having me.
First question.
Sure.
Because we're the COP climate conference has now started in Dubai. We hope that some of these ideas are being discussed along the way. But I wanted to ask you about on the micro level, you were doing your research and your explorations. What did you discover about biodiversity of the desert that you maybe didn't know before?
Right. I'm constantly bewildered by how rich it is. California is only 4% of the North American continent. And actually, the four deserts that I discuss in the book, the Great Basin, the Mojave, the Sonoran, and the Colorado, which is the Sonoran Desert inside of California, that's a different floristic province than the California floristic province. But taken as a whole, the
biodiversity on this little strip of land is outmatched, right? It's outmatched on a planetary level. It's among the great places of the planet in terms of species numbers and in terms of habitat variety and in terms of genetic diversity as well. You know, and I think about how that is not going to change. As we are now, you know, we've got the Sierra Nevada, the longest continuous mountain range in North America, 400 miles, forming what is ostensibly an ecological wall to the other floristic provinces. An ecological island, as Ellen Bacher called it, the seminal book, The Island of California. But then I think of the regular conveyance of San Andreas Fault in the next 10 billion years as it rips the peninsula of Baja off of Mexico and drags it up to then sort of realize Los Angeles as a suburb of the archipelago of what would be San Francisco 10 million years from now. And you think of how island speciation forms, you think maybe the world will then be recovering from the sixth mass extinction. Already imagining what the seventh mass extinction would be like. Will placenta, in that huge island, the diversity of which will contain species that will be due to your wildest imagination, because that is what is going to live there. We have no way of being able to predict if even placental mammals will be something. You know, 10 million years is a good long chunk of time for evolution to work its oven. And, you know, and the inverse of that, in terms of deserts, is that as we talk about spending nature to save nature and this terrible paradox of carbon zero and 30 by 30, you know, we're assuming that there's like a lowest parameter, this essential habitat connectivity that we're attempting to save. We're assuming that that's going to save many. As we continue scraping the earth for energy. These precious organisms that are endemic to the desert environment, every single one of the 72 maps of each desert wilderness space I have in the book here, are every single one has two animals and two plants that have been documented to live in that wilderness area, and I sourced all that information through iNaturalists. So I love that there's like this like democratic component, you know, this sort of like crowdsourcing of information, sort of the citizen science, you know. Hey, that butterfly exists in this wilderness area. That's what about it. Yeah. And then I made like a chart to make sure that like it didn't overlap. You know. But it's just demonstrative of incredible diversity, how complex and how these organisms
rare. Questions? A couple in the back here. We had one. One. Yes.
Thank you.
Well, it's so great that you're here. As you said, the countries are meeting as we speak
yes.
here in Dubai.
Right.
Very subject and how to deal with it. And you mentioned Cornel West and his quote about not being paralyzed by despair.
Very good.
I'm kind of hung up on being paralyzed by despair.
Amen, brother. Talk about hope as agency, right? Hope also as a factor, having a temporal factor. As long as there is time, there is hope. The end of hope is the end of time. You know, and then I'm brought about to something like you know, I mean, one of the reasons why I paint in this calligraphic stance and this posture, engaging creatively, using all of me to describe something quickly rendered through the, it connects me somehow to the ancient forces of form and beauty to my eye, to my heart. And this comes from practice.
there weren't 20 years ago. And I volunteered with Land Trust from Joshua Tree to Crescent City again, and I'm just amazed all the time when I go and I hang out with them, and it's not red and blue, you know, it's just like people who love this open grove redwoods. Everybody loves their redwoods, for example. So I would encourage you to find a community, because I think in the community we have a collective action. Mm-hmm.
Your paintings are beautiful. And I have one at home, and I look at it often, the mountain lion. With the desert, do you have a favorite, and was there one that you...
Favorite
picture painting in there, and was there one that didn't make the book that you are remiss that didn't make it?
I would tear up so many paintings. I mean, you can probably see the one tenth of the paintings that I made. Because most of my paintings take like 10, 15 minutes to make. If I find myself 20 minutes on a painting, it's going to suck. You know, I don't know. Like, overworking, you know, it's best when it's like a dance or a sword fight or something. You know, when it just flows and it becomes like a yoga or a breath. And that is when I can get out of the way of everything. But I will be in a couple of markets over the next couple of weeks selling the originals, actually. I'll be up in St. Helena next week. Many of y'all are in Nevada County and want to come up and see me. I'll be at the winter market in Carter and Company, so it's a big design fair, and I'll table there, and I'm going to be selling my originals. Because, you know, stuff.
So did you have a favorite instead?
Oh, I wish I could answer you. If I were to pick up the book now, I'd go, hey, this one's pretty good.
It's a little bit strange.
But, you know, go to my Instagram, Coyote Thunder, and that's a pretty good daily temperature reading of what I'm thinking is, all right, that's postable, you know, that kind of thing. I've decided pretty much Instagram's where it's at for me. I like that there's creative decisions that are inherent in the platform, and the dialectic is not vitriolic, you know, and at least I avoid all that stuff. So, you know, I appreciate the long form ability as a painter and a poet to put those things together. So that's my social media channel.
Question in the back.
Hi, thank you.
Talk
about the importance of stories. Could you tell us a story from the last year of you in nature if it was particularly special to you?
Yeah. I saw the border wall for the first time. Down there. Oh. What a mistake. What a thing. You know, I mean, I go through certain parts of this city or certain other cities on the peninsula, these blue cities. And, wow, you can really see a lot of border walls there, too. Yeah. He says with the rolling eyes emoji. But, you know, going down and seeing this border wall, and the idea of opportunity and what the West is as opposed to Mexico and all of this.
Do calm down. It has happened in history.
No, we'll okay, see. I'll take that.
A question in the front, make it short.
If I could just skip a stone from loneliness, because it's 97 million people. Can you boost it in the rest state to our schools radiant career? Who is creating the type of curriculum material that can encompass your message? For the people who really are 5, 10, 15 years old, because the rest of the people, those 97 million people, I don't think we can get to them.
Yeah. This is interesting. You know, what is the quality of my voice as an artist? What can I do as a singular individual to promote this democratic idea of the landscape? I don't make tour guides. You know, this is a very serious investigation about how to be. And this is my own investigation. Right? And keeping it on that level, keeping that sort of deconstructing or unpacking the idea of the expert at all, right? I'm inviting you to come along with me on this journey of exploration as I express my affection for this place, all of this place. This isn't about the superlatives of the oldest trees and the tallest trees and whatever. This is about answering the question like, well, what's your favorite place in California? It's like, well, where are you? You know, California is beautiful everywhere. And loving all of it, getting to know all of it, and encouraging the sense of geographic literacy. What is this place? How does it work? Is, I think, a good place to start. And I'm so happy to have quality local publisher Heyday Books stands behind me.
Questions in front? This is our last question.
Okay. I am very curious about what's inside of chemtrails that are being dropped from the stratosphere. They create creepy clouds that blow in the opposite directions of the wind. It's cluttering and it gets in your eyes and your lungs and the soil and the trees. It seems like it must be related to the trees drying out and catching fire more easily. What's in it? Why are they doing this? Nobody's talking about it.
We would have to talk scientific studies. I don't agree. That's not the way wind works.
I know, but the stratosphere blows in one direction. I've seen clouds that are much higher. They blow that way, and the prevailing winds in San Francisco go this way.
I haven't read the evidence.
I've seen it.
Okay.
All right.
I take your word for it.
Every day.
I do also understand, this is kind of a subtle point, that eyewitness accounts are not scientific evidence. Okay, so like, if we're going to have a discussion about this, I encourage
you. But
this guy
becomes great.
And we're going to take this off afterwards.
Okay.
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
Okay, great. Well, I want to thank Obi for an incredibly educational piece of music. About connecting to our natural worlds, the world that we are in right now today, and to protect nature and our environment for the future. For those of you who want to get connected, join the Sierra Club or take a walk around your neighborhood or join a walking tour. Get connected and also be active and vote. So thank you. My books have been signed.